Afrobeats News, bro, guys. It's me, Afrobeats News, and I'm back again with some interesting Afrobeat entertainment. Hope you guys are having a lovely, wonderful day, and you guys should stay blessed while I give you guys some of the latest info in the Nigerian entertainment scene. First off, do you guys know the person called Drake? I mean, the Canadian boy called Drake. You know, these guys are, I think he's pretty known. I don't know about you, but, you know, Drake is, well, I think one of my cousins, right? So he recently followed the one and only Thames. Now, you guys should know that Thames have been recently blowing up in the Nigerian music scene. She was featured on Wizkid's album, in Made in Lagos album, and Thames have just been doing her thing. Of course, we know that there was this incident with what happened to her in Uganda, and ever since then, it just seems like she's getting more popular, more famous. And not just Drake, of course, you have another person that I think you guys might know. He was, you know, the former US president, and I'm sure he's quite popular in your place. He's commonly known as, you know, Obama or Barack Obama, the 45th US president. Now, he recently came out to release his playlist for 2020, and surprisingly, he had Thames on his playlist, as well as, you guys know, the Starboy Wizkid was also in his playlist. So tell me, guys, what do you guys think about this validation from this US, you know, based popular, you know, celebrities and individuals? You have Drake on one hand, which I'm sure all of you know him, as well as, of course, the one and only Mr. Obama. Anyway, moving on to the news of the day, you have Thames and O'Malley formally releasing statements about their arrest in Uganda. In case you guys did not know, Thames and O'Malley recently touched down Nigeria after being detained in Uganda for a while. Here's a clip of them in the Murtala Mohammed Airport. Roll it. Now, of course, once they were in Nigeria, they put out statements as regarding their arrest in Uganda. You had Thames, first of putting out a statement on her Instagram page, and in that statement, this is what she wrote. She wrote, "I'm truly saddened that attendees could have possibly been exposed to COVID-19. I would never have participated if I had even the slightest knowledge that the event would not meet standard operating procedure and put Ugandan citizens at risk." Now, she also went on to thank, you know, the Nigerian government as well as the Ugandan government for the role they played in securing her release. Now, she ended up with this statement in particular. She said, "The past week have been difficult but eye-opening for me. While I was being detained, I met some amazing women and children, and my eyes were open to the strife and hurt a lot of women are going through." Now, with this statement, of course, this actually segue us to another discussion of the day. What do you guys think about the state of prisons around the world? You know, you see Thames coming out here to say that now she's been eye-opened and she now sees the kind of strife that women, you know, go through in prisons, in jails, in, like, around the world. And she specifically is mentioning about, of course, the experience she had in Uganda with, you know, being in the same cells with some of these ladies. But what do you guys think about all of this? You guys think that we should start, especially in Nigeria or in Africa, we should start trying to reform the jail units and, of course, try to reform the prison units so that it can be more conducive? Because despite the fact that some of these people may have committed crimes, we know that at the end of the day, for enough for us to rehabilitate them, we need to give them some of the best of conditions, and so that at least they could, you know, become better people at the end of the day. They shouldn't go to jail and come out worse than they were. So tell me your suggestions, or tell me what you think about Thames' statement as regards, you know, her experience that she went through while she was in detention. And we're moving on to the next. You have, of course, O'Malley putting out statements regarding his experience in a series of tweets. So O'Malley tweeted this. Now, he said, "The past few days have been some of the toughest of my life, and I wouldn't wish them on anyone. Out in a new country with some beautiful people, the next thing, I'm being treated like a common thief. First off, I want to thank all the amazing fans that came out to see me in Uganda. The smiles on your faces that evening would be one of the happiest memories. Also, I want to clarify that putting you in harm's way was never my intention. Before we came out to Uganda, the show promoters confirmed and proved to us they secure all the clearances, which of course included COVID-19 compliance. At that point, my sole obligation became to make myself available to be taken to the venue and entertained, which I did in the full glance and protection of the Ugandan police. Secondly, to my mom, my family, my team, my fans, my friends, I caused sleepless nights praying and waiting for me. I apologize for putting you through all that. Big shout out to the musicians, celebrities, fans, again and again, my family and friends, my label, the Nigerian Mission in Uganda, the Presidency, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Madam Abike, thank you all so much. So this is just pretty much O'Malley putting out the statement. And as regarding his statement, what do you guys think about what went on with O'Malley? I said this in the last video, like, that it seems like O'Malley wasn't aware of what the show was going to be like, because obviously with the statement right now, we can see that he thought, since they got a clearance, it means that it was cleared for COVID-19 protocols and they followed the rules and regulation. Now, it's just so sad that despite the fact that he made sure that whatever show that he was taking up was cleared for the COVID-19 protocols, he did the right thing and he showed up to perform based on his contractual like obligations, that he was still arrested. So what do you guys think about what went down about, like, as regards the whole issue with, you know, the COVID-19 protocol, the Ugandan police and O'Malley? Do you guys think it was fair? Again, I pose a question to you guys. Do you guys think it was fair? Because people are out there that have been saying that, you know, O'Malley should have known better. He shouldn't have performed, seeing that the place was too crowded and it was violating the COVID-19 protocols. Anyway, that's pretty much what went down with that. Moving on to the next news, you have Tems again coming out to blast Bebe Cool. Now, in case you guys don't know who Bebe Cool is, Bebe Cool is a Ugandan-based Afrobeat musician. Now, people have been speculating for long that he was responsible for the arrest of Tems and O'Malley in Uganda. Now, he's been dragged on social media even before Tems came up online to attack him. He was being dragged because it has already been speculated on social media that he was responsible for the arrest. Now, Tems obviously came online and she had to make it known that Bebe Cool was responsible for the arrest. She made this known in this series of tweets. She said, "As Bebe Cool UG, first of all, you are what I call a stinking, dirty effing bitch. Bebe Cool, you called the police on us. You got us arrested, dickless F. Bebe Cool, I know you before. Who the F are you? You follow the police around and bribe them to send you pictures of our release papers so that you can look like you had anything to do with the release. See your head, na piece latrine day inside, not brain. At Bebe Cool UG, your friend broke into our room and took us after you called, only for me to see you in the DPO's office, chilling and laughing with him. Laughing your ass off in my presence, and you thought I would sit there and allow you to speak to me. You are worse than shit. At Bebe Cool UG, I swear avoid Nigeria for the rest of your life. If you ever find out I'm in the same place as you, run for your life, because I will not be in chains and nothing will stop me from pouncing on you. You should cut off your dick. It's clearly too small to be useful." Now, Tems finally tweeted this. "This is the last time I'm speaking about this. Enjoy the clout at Bebe Cool UG. It is the most you ever get in your life." Now, with this tweet, this series of tweets being put out there, it turned out that the tide just came hard on Bebe Cool, because the whole social media was coming after this guy. It was as if Bebe Cool was one of the worst person, like, in Africa. You had Ugandans was dragging this guy, Nigeria was dragging this guy, to the point where this guy was pressured to actually put out a video statement addressing what went down. Let's roll the clip for you.
"Of course, because of the COVID, we have been stopped from performing for the last 9 months. So I was like, definitely, it's not possible for a concert to happen in Uganda, okay? If Ugandan artists are not performing, how is it possible that there is a foreign artist coming into Uganda to stage a concert? So my concern was, first of all, that. Then my second concern at that moment was how those people got licenses to perform, to organize a concert, because all of us, we've lost finances. This is a year. Usually when I do my concert, I probably earn about $150,000, $200,000, okay? But we have all been put down completely. So it definitely is my concern as a legendary artist, as a straightforward person. So I put up the post and said, I hope the authorities jump onto this, because the period in which we are, the reliable information that I had gotten, this guy has locked you down for 9 months, but look, he has allowed foreign artists to come and perform in Uganda. So that was reliable information. That was the second one. So I posted that so that authorities can intervene or can hear it out and say, how is it possible? Guess what? After posting, that's when I was called and I was told, you know what? This is not a concert. These guys have applied. The application is saying they're having a branch. Okay? They're having a branch and it's 150 people. And after the brunch, they'll have a dinner of 150 people in the evening. So those are two private events. So definitely I could understand why they had the license, and that was okay. So that's how later on 2 hours, actually not even 2 hours, 1 hour, I removed the post. And then that was the end of Bebe. The next time I hear anything to do with this whole thing is on Sunday at night. I think, yes, Sunday night. Okay, that's about 1 o'clock, 1 p.m. When one of the big people is calling me and telling me, you know what, baby, I got a call from Nigeria. This person is a big person in Nigeria. He wants you to intervene in this situation. If you can make some calls, you have some contacts. The Nigerian artists have been arrested. So I'm like, arrested? Why? So unfortunately, the artist, Omar, had taken a selfie picture. So that's the picture that alarmed security organizations. Immediately when they got that on Saturday night, I think that the police started to organize itself and pursued these people. There was actually a video too that showed the whole situation. So I make calls that whole night, and in the morning I...
Now, with what he put out, what do you guys think about, you know, what went down between Bebe Cool and Thames? Do you think that Bebe Cool was right in, you know, informing the police, and what happened was just that things just escalated and went out of hand? Or do you think that he was wrong? Despite his explanation, he was on the wrong for getting the police involved and everything. Anyway, guys, that's pretty much what I have for you guys today. Don't forget to like and subscribe.